used everything
Yes, yes,
what we
yes.
have done in our lab.
Yes,
Means
yes.
this is the work that is actually published from our lab. So
Okay.
there is a huge amount of work other places,
Yes.
but I have taken those so that I am confident of what I am speaking.
Yes, yes. And it also added value
to the lab and to ourselves.
We have done in our lab.
Yes.
This is the work that is.
Now we are in YouTube live, and I giving 2-3 share of this thing in Facebook. Bio. Hi Neha.
Hi.
Sir is
Shall we
there.
Start? Yeah.
We are live in YouTube. Now I'm going to start recording and broadcast. Okay. Now we allow the attendees.
Yeah, they are joining.
Yes. Neha, today you look into the Zoom box, Zoom message and all the thing. I'll do the YouTube.
Okay.
And
people are joining fast.
Yes, it's full.
Let's give them like.
They are actually waiting. They are waiting. They are just waiting for that. We have. Thank you. Jacinta just came. I asked if you see one. Hi, Jacinta. Hello. Sir, I want to introduce she is Jacinta. Jacinta now doing her postdoc in Canada. And is a good plant biotechnologist. Is
have you're doing a, from NCBI?
No. Jacinta is not from there. Neha is from NRCGB. ICGB.
No, I was asking, Jacinta, you are in Saskatchewan?
No, I'm in University of Calgary.
Achcha. Because we had a collaborative program with Raju Dutla and Simmons there. With Saskatchewan.
Okay, great.
Actually, their timing is very different.
Yeah, no, it's middle of night.
It's quite late.
We can start.
We were just waiting for the participants to join as we have opened the link. I think we can start in 2-3 minutes. I'm not able to hear.
Sure, inaudible.
Yeah, now sound is coming.
Is it okay?
Yeah, now okay. You're not.
Okay, so I just introduce. Hello, welcome to BioEngine webinar. Today we have with as an esteemed scientist, Dr. Bharadwaj Sir of the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, Delhi, India. He will be delivered a talk on genomic assisted breeding for chickpea improvement. We have received more than 3,000 registration for today's webinar. Thank you all for your interest in the BioEngine webinar series. The webinar joining link is posted on our website, and we are now live in our YouTube channel. I have with me my team will help to conduct today's webinar. Neha will introduce our speaker. After the webinar, we will take questions from the audience related to today's topic. We have arranged a short interview session with our speaker, which will be conducted by Soma. I am sure it will motivate our young viewers. Important notice and information like process of registration, certification collection will be provided by the Soma after the question answer round. Let's begin the webinar. I request Neha to introduce our speaker. Neha.
Thanks, Shubhavrata. Welcome to today's webinar organized by BioEngine. BioEngine is a non-profit organization created to promote plant research worldwide. The webinar series was designed to build a platform from where plant scientists can present their research to the world. We hope future scientists can gain perspective and inspiration by listening to the esteemed plant researchers talk about their scientific accomplishments and their thoughts on the future of plant science. We are grateful that many renowned scientists have accepted our invitation to share their research insights with us. We are also thankful to the audience for the interest in bioengineering webinars. We have received a huge response of over 3,000 registrations for today's webinar. We are you can view us through Zoom and on our YouTube live channel. Video recordings of today's events will be available on our YouTube channel. It is our request to all viewers to please hold all questions for the question and answer round at the end of the presentation. You can type in your questions in the comment box, which will be opened right after the presentation. The certificate application link and the password will also be available after the presentation. So the topic for today's webinar is genomics assisted breeding for chickpea improvement by Dr. Bhardwaj. Dr. Bhardwaj holds 22 years of scientific experience in breeding legumes and pulses. As a breeder par excellence, he is focused on marginal and submarginal chickpea farmers to increase their livelihood through developing 8 chickpea varieties having climate resilience. He has led several multidisciplinary and multinational grants and projects during the last 20 years. He is the principal investigator for the prestigious $8 million ICAR Bill Melinda Gates Foundation project on application of next generation breeding, genotyping, and digitalization approaches for improving the genetic gain in Indian staple crops. He leads several other projects in collaboration with ICRISAT, ICARDA, University of Western Australia, University of Saskatoon, and so on. He is also the ICRISAT steering team member for the GOB2 program. He is an elected fellow of Indian Society of Pulses Research and Development, Kanpur, India, and has been a serving counselor for Northwest Zone for 2 terms, and the fellow of Indian Society Genetics and Plant Breeding, New Delhi, India. He has published more than 120 papers in peer-reviewed journals, apart from various book chapters, books, and technical reports. He is also a core committee member for the development of descriptors for Biodiversity International BRL trials of DBT for chickpea, chairman member on various panels and research committees and interview boards, including managing committee of IIPR Kanpur and chairman of various selection committees. I now request Dr. Bhardwaj to take over and start his talk. Please share your screen, sir.
It's already shared.
Yeah.
Thank you for the young webinar hosting team, my friend Shuo, Soma, Liberty from UC Davis, Jacinta from Canada, Neha from Adelaide. It was really heartening when this young group of budding scientists have started this non-profit platform to bring in and showcase the best in research that is happening in plant science. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. I should be speaking on genomic assisted breeding for chickpea improvement, basically concentrating on the work that has been principally taken up by the chickpea molecular breeding group at ICAR, particularly at IRI, that's my lab. Whenever we look at sustainable development, which actually means that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generation. So this includes 5 things, when you're looking at prosperity, to ensure prosperity, here we look at farmers' prosperity and soil sustainability, to look at peace, that is meeting hunger, to look at partnerships for research and frontiers, to protect our natural resources, and to weigh that we overcome the things. But what are the major challenges when we look down at international agriculture per se, so that we have a look into why this becomes that we need to apply these modern breeding tools for crop improvement program. Population is burgeoning at a whooping rate. India itself is adding the whole of Australia and Europe in every year, and we have more mouths to feed. And if you look down, this is happening with limited arable land. Most of the arable land, which is besides rivers, getting converted into what you call as housing and other things, and an increasing water scarcity, rising climate, and with increased CO2 levels. So the big challenge is we need to now create more food. This more food needs to be created using less resources. The less resources include less arable land, less water, less labor, and even migration of already available agricultural labor, as well as farmers who find industry and other petty jobs as more remunerative. At the same time, we also understand that the water footprints to produce 1 kg of a particular crop is very high, and is much so higher in case of animal products. So the whole idea is that we need to increase the food production almost by a staggering 60% by 2050, hardly 30 years, to feed our rapid growing population. And this indicates much, much higher than the 1.9% annual growth that we got it. So where does this translational genomics, when we are basically speaking, fit into agriculture? We do understand the most important is development of advanced breeding lines or development of varieties. But this is not a, what you say, an step in its own. A lot of pre-breeding activities, as well as translational genomic activities, or what you call as the related crop activities take place. The whole idea is that we need to have variability so that the breeder is able to select this variability for utilizing in crop improvement. And where does this variability come from? This particular variability comes from the germplasm, right? So whether we have by now a lot of plant genetic resources, research that has gone by the way of developing cores, by the way of developing mini cores, or using focused intensive germplasm screening approach, FIGS approach, as well as some of the breeders who have developed nested association mapping populations or multi-parent advanced generation intercross or the mapping populations. These all form the genetic resources or the germplasm material, which were resourced by using the landraces, the cultivars or wilds, which are present in the gene bank. And the use of computational or the genomic resources has made us identify the quantitative linked loci, or genomic estimated breeding values, or the phenotyping techniques, including the lysimeter or the more modern phenomics facilities, which gave us idea of which are the genes that are functioning, or if not, if which are the QTLs that are linked to the various genes that are actually going, and how these are actually inherited, or maybe simple breeding tools, which give you to understand the stability of certain characters as well as the genotypes. So once this information is available, we start moving towards what is called as genomic assisted breeding, pre-breeding, or the conventional breeding, to have a large set of segregating lines on which selection can be made. Now, if you look into the history of plant breeding, as I said, variability is must, and selection of superior types was essential. Earlier, the breeders in before 1900 were following what we call as phenotypic selections, isn't it? So slowly what happened is Mendel introduced his what you call as principles, and then slowly we have moved into the cytogenetics principle by the Morgan group. And then we started looking at with Sir Ronald A. Fisher, the biometrical techniques that have come to play. And when the biometrical techniques have come to play, lot of the people who were using initially the phenotypic variances started looking with this belief whether this would greatly help or not. With analysis of variants and application of biometrical techniques, we have got a statistical tool with which we validate our results. And then the cycle continued. And as the tissue culture techniques of 1970 to the 2000, where the genomic techniques started coming into play. I myself remember as a student in 1995 to 98 at IRA, where we were using the isogenes and the rapid markers just came into play, and we were a bit very new to these techniques, but the world was looking to whether this would actually solve. But let me tell you, these are the tools. And what happens is, it is important that the breeders or the crop improvement persons, including in any field, use these tools to increase your precision of experiments or increase your precision of selection or prevent what you call as lag, so that you are able to actually target the trait of interest. Exactly like my close friend and collaborator Rajiv Varshne puts it, so we have come into a stage where we have now 5 G's for crop improvement, which they published in Current Opinion and Plant Biology. If you look down, one is the genome. So you require to have the whole genome assembly for a given crop species. Legumes initially, and particularly pulses, were orphan crops, but thanks to the efforts of ICADA, ICRISAT, including Saskatchewan and other universities, what happened is we now have a large genome assembly for most of the legume crops, which are widely grown, and particularly so of chickpea. See, the availability of genome assembly gives us an idea that we can use the bioinformatics tools to identify the gene complexes. At the same time, having germplasm characterized at the genomic level as well as agronomic level will help us to identify the genes of interest. But most important is, we are moving to how we can use this in genomic breeding. I'm not speaking of just marker-assisted breeding, but I'm looking at genomic breeding where we use the modern genomic approaches, that is genomic estimated breeding values. And of course, slowly the new technology of gene editing is coming. So as we move on, we understand that we have marker-assisted selection or marker-assisted backcrossing or marker-assisted recurrent selection. The availability of these tightly linked markers, which we use in the forward breeding or genomic selection approaches. So you all know, but for the global audience in general, I would like to say that chickpea is one of the largest grown legume or the pulse crop in the country. It is first in India, and it stands second after peas, dry peas. Now, it is not only that, it has a large amount of medicinal properties, and India contributes to more than 90% area, more than 90% of the production. But alas, when we start looking at the productivity, it is roughly stagnating to less than 1 ton per hectare over years. Now, there is a huge gap between this potential yield, that is about 3 to 5 tons per hectare that has been achieved, and the average yield that is still less than 1 ton. And it is now that we are started looking, how do we start to reduce this particular achievable yield with that that we are achieving, even in what you call as production plots. So when we are looking at such things, we look that the program of chickpea, particularly in India, is actually rooted through Indian Institute of Pulse Research under the directorship of Dr. N.P. Singh and coordinating by Dr. G.P. Dikshit. And we have about 5 zones, each zone characterized by a specific angle. For example, we have the Northwest Plain Zone, which was once the heartthrob of chickpea production, but from 1980s to 90s, this whole production started moving to the central and southern India. And this what we call as the South Zone and the Central Zone, and Madhya Pradesh is rightly called as the pulse state, where a large amount of pulses, not only chickpea, including other pulses, are produced. Every zone is characterized by certain priority traits, which we have been doing. And we started this exercise in the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation project. For example, for Central and South India, I broadly grouped them. We require early maturing, high temperature and drought tolerant varieties. At the same time, biotic resilience to dry root rot, wilt, collar rot resistance. In case of Kabuli, we are looking at 100 seed weight of 50 grams or more, which is called as the extra large seeded Kabuli, and we are moving slowly towards mechanized harvesting. An excellent program, which is now bearing fruit, started by Dr. Gaur and group from ICRISAT, as well as partners from the National Agricultural Research System. Now we are looking towards east. East, when I mean to say Northeast Plains, which also includes Eastern UP, Bihar, West Bengal, Plains of Assam, Orissa, where we are looking at not only high temperature and short duration tolerance, but looking at wilt and water rate is gray mold. And when I'm looking at the Northwest Plain zones, we are looking at cold, Ascochyta blight, wilt resistance. So now you see, I'm a breeder who is working from the northern part of the country, but my major area lies in the central and the south zone, and the area in future which I'm looking to is Northeast Plain zones. So you need to try to look what are the basic needs and necessities of this zone. And if you look into the area production and yield of chickpea, as we look down, particularly if you look at yield graph, we did increase, but then there was no substantial increase in the productivity per hectare. We may argue that yes, we take more than one crop per year, but certainly when your own research productivity indicates 3 to 5 tons, it is not so actually showing in the farmer's level. See, there are two advantages if you are able to achieve this. One, you will be able to relieve more land to other crops. We require a cafeteria of different crops, not only chickpea alone. Then, since if you are able to increase this productivity from marginal lands, we will be providing resilience to this resource poor farmer. And this was the target of the present regime or present research focus. So as I'm saying, so what are these strategies that we are looking into? As I said, whether it is the genetic resources or the genomic resources, what we are trying to basically target is the genes. Utilize these genes into the improvement of crops, whether using the conventional approaches or the marker-assisted approaches or the genetic engineering technologies to provide genotypes. That means what we are trying to do, we are trying to better predict the phenotypes from the genotype or the gene information that we have. And this is where an integrated approach of the physiologists, the biochemists, the agronomists, as well as stabilizing scientists, that is the entomologists and the pathologists, come into role into a pool, and we need to use it. So whenever we are looking at genomic assisted breeding, leave aside in chickpea, or if you are using in any other crop, so you require certain criteria for the full utilization of these modern molecular tools. Number one, these are not going to supplant the breeder. They're going to supplement the breeder. So you need to have a robust breeding program. It is not a panacea. It is a good aid tool. So you need to have a very robust breeding program. Mind you, we need to have a large scale field screening. What I mean to say is large scale field screening is you need to have precise phenotyping tools. Without precise phenotyping tools, over locations, over environments, you'll be actually making a molecular phenotype again, which will be of no usefulness. And you may end up developing QTLs, which are different for different locations. Let's say if I'm doing phenotyping at Hyderabad, if I'm doing phenotyping at UWA Perth, if I'm doing phenotyping at Delhi with the same population, and if I am not able to reduce the environmental effect, that means if my phenotyping is not precise, then what happens is I'll be having different QTLs for different places. And a new rubber breeder who starts with this will be confused. Then we need to have the people who can actually use these tools precisely, who can use this, understand which tool to be used where. Now, this becomes very, very important. In most of my classes, when I start to it, I start with a simple way of making you understand that you have a group of subjects, right? Let's say this group is about 500 and odd people who have joined into the webinar. This group consists of both the male and the female, right? Now, if I use gender as a tool of classification, these 500 group people or the 500 subjects will be classified just into two groups, the male group and the female group. If I use, let's say, geographical isolation as a criteria, the same group which has been classified into two groups, there will be intermixing and maybe we'll have 5 or 7. Or if I start using age as a criteria, maybe 8 groups. You see, the number of subjects which I've taken is same. They're the 500. But when I use a different statistical intervention, what basically happens is the grouping changes. Similarly, these are all interventions that you are going to use. For example, if you are going to use just the morphological D-square analysis, you have with the same subjects two different groups. You are using a principal component analysis, same subject, some other groups. If you are using SSR markers, same subject, different groups. Is the grouping wrong? Not at all. So as a breeder or as a person who is making this group, it is pertinent of you to understand why are you making this group. For example, you have a very, very large germplasm and you want to fastly delineate them into homogeneous groups. Then using a simple metroglyph technique, which uses the two most variable characters, is just sufficient. And within this smaller homogeneous groups, you may use a principal component approach to have much more precise, closely related groups. And within them, you may use the molecular tools. This is very, very essential so that you are able to handle your resources more importantly. You certainly require a strong biotechnology and bioinformatics team. And most important, you require an healthy interdisciplinary approach, not to supplant each other's duties, but to supplement each of the one. So that's how we do it, particularly in my lab, where we have a strong breeding and research program group, and we work as a marker service lab. We also use the facilities of ICRISAT and ICARDA to actually strengthen our breeding program along with the National Institute of Agricultural Biotechnology. The markers have been evolving. I've been speaking this thing in the initial stages. While I started my career, as I said, we started with isogenes, then came the RFLPs, and now we are under the SNP or DART. But how are these useful? They are useful in different programs. For example, I structured my lecture in a way that means in, for example, diversity analysis, in development of maps, in utilizing these QTLs identified by various mapping techniques in marker-assisted breeding program and genomic-assisted breeding program. And so similarly, I'll be taking you in the saga of journey of my 22 years of scientific ladder. When you start looking, what basically happened is when we started looking at the chickpea breeding, everywhere we were hearing, and including an analysis that we have done and my students have done, we have seen that the base, the genetic base of chickpea was very narrow, and we were actually unable to get large amount of genetic gains. Was it actually narrow? So this was what we started doing, and we published one in way back in 2011. Later, one of my students, Snehapriya, who is also working along with ICARDA, Dr. Sarkar, Dr. Shivkumar Agrawal, Tapan, and Rijvi. What we have done is we were able to obtain about 166 land races. As you can see, some of them are from the Vana region, that is the West Asia and the North Africa region. Some of them were from the Indian subcontinent. They were spread across the globe. And what we have started looking is, we started also obtaining those lines which were available in the ICRISAT germplasm, basically of the Indian origin. We also looked at the National Agricultural Research System derived and developed lines and varieties. We also started looking at those which were wild species and started using a clustering technique. And we could see that was a clear-cut branching. That means this clearly indicated the lines of the Vana region, West Asia and North Africa, those that were from these regions, certainly were quite diverse, irrespective of whether they were the lines from different areas in India or from the ICRISAT germplasm of the Indian origin. This actually indicated that we can actually achieve greater gains by using these lines in a pre-breeding approach. And what we started doing is we started developing robust mapping populations using these lines with specific traits. And we started looking whether we can start using them in development of maps. There were already a large number of maps when we had published this particular map developed in the country from my collaborator and co-author also, Dr. Sabyata Bhatia, Dr. Varshney and group, as well as Winter and Huttle. But what we have seen when we have seen of these maps is most of these maps have used wild derivatives or reticulatum into arytenum crosses. Beautiful maps developed, a large amount of polymorphism. But when we started using most of these polymorphic markers in the cultivated lines, none of them amplified. Maybe one of the reason of this is that these were actually skewed towards showing polymorphism of the wild genomic pool or the land race pool. And that's where we hit upon the idea that can we develop a map using desi into kabulin? And when we started developing, this was a very, sparse map, as you call it as. But this was the first desi into kabuli or intraspecific map in the country or second in the world after Cobos et al. And what we started now looking is, can we actually increase the density of the markers that were available? And along with Dr. Sabyata Bhatia in an Indo-Canadian pulse genomics initiative with University of Saskatchewan, we started looking at how to saturate this particular map, characterize them for various yield parameters. The both of the mapping populations were what you call as both the mapping population was quite sound with one of the parent, which we call as simple desi mutant, which had almost 100 seed weight of 35 grams. And we used it with a BGD 112, a green leaf seeded, green seeded and stay green variety, which had seed weight of 16 gram. And we could actually develop a large number of novel ESTs, 367. And then we could actually place about 131 markers onto this, again done by Shefali, Dr. Sabyata's student and Tapan Mai's student. And we could actually saturate this map to a greater length. But still we found that of the QTLs that we have identified, there was a wide gap for these yield QTLs. And we thought we need to actually look how we can further dense it. And we started making SNPs, genomic SNPs, and we could get almost 4,000 high quality SNPs, and they were most of them, 40% is a large amount present in genic regions. Again, done in a collaborative work with Dr. Sabyata and our group. Sabyata Bhatia is the staff scientist from National Institute of Plant Genomic Research in Delhi itself. And we started constructing and we could get a very dense map. It is one of the most densest map. Not only that, we could identify the QTLs, but we didn't stop here. What we said is the utility of these QTLs will only occur when we start using, first we validate them. Most of the map or biotechnological work stops in most in case of QTLs is just by identifying and publishing. But me and my partner thought that we need to validate these QTLs and start using in the breeding program. And what we started looking is, can we actually really use? Because what we were doing is we were identifying QTLs for seed size, and there was a lot amount of criticism, particularly in the committees, where they say, why do you want to do for seed size? It has very high heritability. The heritability is as high as 80%. But what me and Dr. Sabyata always argued is, we are not looking at post-harvest seed size. We are able to, if this marker information is there, we'll be able to select them at the seedling stage and cull out. And this is how we hit upon, can we actually use it in the breeding program? And when Tapan was with me as my doctoral student, we started using one of the line that was supplied by Icarda, Goxi. This is a highly drought-tolerant line. It is actually released as a variety in Ethiopia. And we had one very bold line, Fulagi 0515, which was developed by the Maharashtra University. And we wanted to actually include the bold seed size along with the drought tolerance characters. And we could get a large amount of variations. But at the same time, what we started doing is, we started looking for the QTLs in the seedling stage itself. And for those plants which had the maximum number of these QTLs, we started intercrossing them. And what happened exactly, this was a collaborative work. Again, the intercrossings were taken up along with my friend at PAU Ludhiana, Dr. Sarvajit, and now Dr. Shaila has joined from there. And you can see, now we have, when we are speaking of small seed and speaking of seed whose 100 seed weight is 50 grams, which is actually designated as extra large or extra bold seeded kabuli types in the AACRP systems. And we have medium bold, which I'm calling, which is 56 grams, and extra bold. And this year, along with Dr. Chauhan, who's the technical officer here, we have started taking the evaluation of these lines. At the same time, one of my students, Rinki and Shubha, they were actually fingerprinting all these land races that have been obtained from this Vana region. And while we have been fingerprinting, we could understand, because we had some prior genetic information and marker related information that were linked tightly to these gene-based markers, we could identify, for example, Ascochyta blight linked QTLs, which were amplified. Similarly, MIP transcription factor, which were FAC analogs. Similarly, dehydrin gene analogs, because we have used the gene-based markers. Then we started looking, if these are there, why don't we start looking at developing a mass-based program? And when you start looking at development of mass-based program, this is basically, I'm speaking of pulses. It was only in marker development along in the Center of Excellency in Genomics, ICRISAT, was doing a lot of work, and also NIPGR. And it was only in 2000s and 2010s where a large amount of marker development was going. And from 2010 to 14, I can say identification of QTLs in a tightly linked fashion. There were few that were identified even before, but there was a large distance between the QTL identified as well as gene of interest or trait of interest. The validation which has occurred, this was the time where roughly around 2007 or 8, when I had joined into the CHICPI program at Indian Agricultural Research Institute, from initially working at Indian Institute of Soybean Research, Indore. So I thought, if we start now using this available technology into marker-assisted selection. Thanks to CIMIT, we were given a generation challenge program, which was basically for utilizing the already identified markers in forward breeding. And my colleague, Teresa Milan from Coroba University, has actually identified on linkage group 2 in case of chickpea, a hotspot. I call this hotspot because it harbors almost 4 genes for the Fusarium wilt and 2 for Ascochyta blight, Ascochyta blight rabe, Ascochyta rabe. So we started actually validating these markers as well as developing our own markers using the NPTC program along with Dr. Soren, who is also a co-author on this at IAPR Kanpur. And we could actually identify a set of SSR markers which were tightly linked to different genes, actually published by different group of workers. We had validated, we could get about 20 markers tightly linked, and we started using this. Now, at the phenotypic level, we have a very good wild sick plot. That's right. And most of our breeders say, Dr. Saab, there is no need for developing molecular markers because I have a wild sick plot which works very well. These wild sick plots are race specific or race predominant. For example, we have a very good wild sick plot in IRI, which is mostly for FOC3 and FOC4 based, mostly FOC4 based. Now, what I was telling to my friends and colleagues in the breeding system is, sitting at Delhi, what I was basically trying to do is develop lines and varieties that need to go into AACRP system, which can work very well good at the Central India and South India, where the majority area is there, or I need to pyramid, and which this thing does not permit. Though this here you see, you could actually see lines which are highly tolerant or in a segregant population where you can see most of them died, but we have certain lines. But within these lines, I could identify even in advanced stages where which were having pyramided for most of the FOG genes, 2, 3, 4, 5. That is for South India, for Central India, and for the Northwest Plain zones. As I said, initial work by my student Shubha et al, as well as Rinki, could identify certain of the QTLs for Ascochyta blight and QTLs for wilt, and our Indo-Canadian pulse genomics initiative, as well as NPTC program, could identify the yield QTLs under drought. We thought, can we mobilize them from the wild species? We started using 372 as well as some other lines and echinospermum based crosses. And one of my students has already published this, how you are able to broaden the base. Now, what we started looking is, we started looking if we can use only the QTLs which were tightly linked to our FOG genes, TR19 and TR110, and only introgress this particular region into our recipient parent, let's say PUSA 372. We have used a large amount of mega varieties, and we could get lines which were having only this particular introgress segment, as well as we could also check out this green line indicates what is called as the yield QTLs. And as we go ahead, I'll show you the purple, which indicates the drought QTLs. And we could develop lines. See, when we started screening under this drought stress, I'll be showing you a time lag photo. For example, when we have sown, almost all the things survived. Early wilt sets in about 20 days around after sowing, 20 to 28 days, depending on the climatic conditions when we sow down in the October ending in the North Indian conditions. As you look into this time lag photo, you'll see that from this initial lines, those which were initially susceptible to early wilt, these all have actually perished, leaving some of the lines. This is an early wilt check, BGD 1005 and WR315. And as we progress and as late wilt starts setting in, almost all the lines started perishing. They were killed by the pathogen, except for this land race from Latvia, ILC0. And as the line towards maturity goes, we could see that only this particular line, you see in the backdrop, almost all the lines in this field, this is Dr. Neil Turner. So all the lines in the field have actually perished except for this line. This is under a collaborative program with ICARDA, which is now hosted in Lebanon, which we are looking. This has stayed green. Now, what we started doing is using this line in our program, as well as using some of our elite lines, we started developing a large amount of breeding lines, and we have started using markers in a foreground selection. We also now started one more program along with Dr. Praveen Verma in NIPGR, where we have started specifically targeting two or three mega varieties to actually pyramid both for wilt and Ascochyta blight, and also with ICRISAT in our NPTC program. So when we look, we started even validating what you call as a large amount of markers. And we have a huge amount of marker-assisted backcross lines. The check completely died. The one of the, what you call as parent, which is not so good, and you have highly tolerant families as well as lines. You look the parent versus these lines, which are now totally resistant. This is the power of marker-assisted breeding. And we didn't stop there. We wanted to actually use them for farmers. And under the chairmanship of Dr. N.P. Singh and Dr. Deekshit, an all-India coordinated special trial for wilt-resistant introgression lines was started 2 years back. And we've entered our lines, and other breeders have also entered from various centers. And you can look, this has now completed 2 years of testing. This year it was into its 2 years of second year of testing, BGM 20211 and BGM 20212, which has almost, if this is the recurrent parent PUSA 391, which we have used, we have about 20 to 30% higher yield and showing resistance across 8 wilt specific plots across the country, across the zones, indicating that these are pyramided for the wilt or the fog alleles. So we generally almost have a large set of 61 pyramided MABC lines for the foreground selection. We have validated what we call as 5 markers, including one by Dr. Mahinder Tudi, which is a SNP marker, which we have validated, but we'll be validating for the second year this time. Initially, people take about 4 or 5 markers for background selection, but we have almost used 10. So 98 background markers apart from these 5. We have a large number of marker-assisted derived back crossbred lines, which have been evaluated for common trials, of which 2 are in AVT1 and 2 are in AVT2. So the second one, so if this is one example where marker-assisted or genomic-assisted breeding can help, for example, breeding for resilience to biotic stresses. We have another program which we are doing along with Dr. Aditya Pratap and Sarvajit of IIPR Kanpur and PAU for Ascochyta blight pyramiding and wilt pyramiding. But one more trait, the abiotic stress resilience. My lab is working both on the drought as well as salinity. We have just initiated the programs on heat. And when you look at these, when you look into particularly the chickpea production, thanks Rajiv for this slide. This is an old slide, never though. You see that the largest yield robber is drought. And of course, afterwards is the pod borer. Pod borer, you have very good management strategies, though the resistance is not available and only the transgenic approach, which Dr. Sharma and his group at ICRISAT, Dr. Bidyut Sharma from Assam and the group are actually working on it, along with IIPR, Indian Institute of Pulse Research. But we were actually looking at drought and do we have any means? Now, when you start looking at drought, just like yield, you have a concept. The concept says that the tolerance, not resistance, is governed by several factors and several pathways. It's complex, just like the yield. Now, there can be phenotypic characters, leaf rolling, or higher silica content, greater, better physiological, for example, relative water content, membrane stability index, or biochemical characters, or as such root mass index, threshold of leaf expansion, rate of transpiration. So there are large number of characters and different genes or QTLs govern these characters. They need to be pyramided into suitable background. This was very much understood. Conventional breeding approaches are time consuming. And the problem with the pulses in general, chickpea in particular, is whenever some land comes into irrigation, the farmer starts taking up the staple food crops like the rice, wheat, and maize. It's but natural. These feed his stomach. And then chickpea is always thrown into its what we call as marginal and submarginal lands. And therefore, the SAT, the semi-arid tropics, host a large amount of these pulses apart from millets. So we need to immediately build upon tolerance to drought as well as heat and salinity. And we need to actually identify and develop lines to have the yield resilience with these particular characters. While my student, Dr. Santosh, who is now in CICR Nagpur, was working for his doctoral thesis, we have seen that there were great differences in the performance of Desi and Kabuli types under non-stressed and stressed environments. And particularly when we were looking, we have seen that drought particularly affects pods. Pods invariably affect the seeds, right? So it was very important that we understand that what happens and which place this becomes critical. We have seen that it may happen because lesser number of pods. That means the drought initiated at the flowering stage, leading to a large number of flower drop. Number two, at the pod initiation stage, therefore lesser number of filled grains or filled seeds per pod, therefore reduction in the number of filled pods, so having more puffs. So we started looking and thought that we need to actually target this particular trait. And we need to actually delineate this trait in terms of different characters. So we started looking at characters and Ikrisat and group, particularly with Dr. Rajiv Krishnamurthy Wades, were identifying the root traits. And Dr. P.K. Jain and my group also here in the National Project on Transgenic Crops, particularly related to functional genomics component, were looking at above ground traits. So why this particular thing was necessitated? This particular thing was necessitated because you need to understand the ontology of drought in South Indian conditions to the North Indian conditions, or down of equator, because chickpea is grown in Africa, and down of equator to the north of equator. Now, when you look into down of equator around January, when the summer solstice starts, what happens is the drought is gradual. That is, water stress is gradual after January 14th or so. And then it slowly starts increasing. And therefore, there is a good amount of time for root to respond to this increasing moisture stress. It's totally different. So when you start looking at North Indian conditions or to the north of equator, wherever in the world it is, what happens is you see there is almost a beautiful conducive stage for chickpea growth or for the pulses growth, which are the winter season pulses or the post-rainy pulses. And you see that they grow normally. The season is very good till February, March ending. And suddenly from April, the temperature shoot, and the shooting is by 10 to 12 degrees. Somewhere from 30 degrees, suddenly the temperature shoots to 38 degrees. And this does not allow the root as such per se to actually respond to this increasing drought. Root biomass generally and root length play a role. I don't deny the fact, but that we need to have above ground factors. And that's where we started looking at what are the above ground traits. And after almost trying about 15 traits along with my colleague earlier, Dr. Deshmukh, who is now in US and the ex-head, and with current my chickpea partner, Dr. Madan Pal, we saw that it was relative water content, membrane stability index, apart from the root traits that play a role. So we started looking at identifying cutials, because already Dr. Rajiv Varshney's group was working very well on these root cutials. We started looking if we can start looking at this above ground traits. And what we started using is a rapid phenotyping technique, which was developed in Lentil by my colleague Dharmender Singh, which was published in Plant Breeding, a hydroponics technique. Some may argue against it, but I found it very useful for rapidly delineating. So initial screening can easily be done, and that's what we have done. And we could identify a good amount of polymorphic variation for these two traits, both for relative content and membrane stability index. And along with Dr. P.K. Jain, we started looking if we can actually develop a map for this particular thing. And we could identify using SSR markers a large amount of cutials, both for membrane stability index as well as for relative water content. And we could find robust cutials which had an additive effect, explaining almost 18 to 20% variation, particularly for membrane stability index. And we have done this almost over 3 years over normal environment as well as rain-fed environment, using both the rainout shelter facilities that very kindly Dr. N.P. Singh, Director IAPR, could actually provide for this program. And what we were looking is, when we identified QTLs, we said, is there any other specific difference? Can we actually look into it? And we have seen that in case of legumes, unlike cereals, when you look into cereals, what happens? Basically, the vegetative phase is totally stopped and the reproductive phase comes. Though it is initiated or differentiated at the CRI stage or the crown root initiation stage. That's not so in case of legumes. What happens in legumes, the reproductive parts are axial. And therefore, even my teacher, Dr. Sonakia from JNKVV, Jabalpur, used to say, and as well as Deshmukh, that we need to look into not just harvest index, but plant biomass per se. And when Dr. Deshmukh was here in his emeritus, we have done this experiment later, the legacy being continued by Madan Pal, where we have seen that those cultivars which were having higher biomass in the initial stages before flowering were the lines that were more drought tolerant, but also these were inherently also carrying greater membrane stability index and relative water content, be it Pusa 72, Pusa 362, and Pusa 1103. Friends, let me tell you, these three are just not from IRI studies. It was done under the first Australia-India Strategic Research Fund program, wherein we have used 15 locations in India and South Asia, as well as about 10 locations in Australia. And Pusa 362 is one of the line that ranked highest. And we started looking if we can actually identify some genes which were actually playing a major role. A large number of genes have been identified by Spruti under our guidance with Dr. Varshni. And we have shortlisted a few of these genes along with Manish Rurkiwal for actually identifying which of these genes play a major role in drought stress. And when we started looking at the graphical genotyping, again, Manu, my student, Tappan and Supriya have done, they have identified after screening a large amount of germplasm, evaluating it at multiple locations, and then trying to identify, we have seen that ethylene responsive binding factor, sucrose phosphate synthase pathway factor has differentially expressed in different genotypes. For example, in RSG 888, if it was EREB that was expressing, in ICC 4958, which is a well-documented donor universally, both EREB and sucrose phosphate synthase pathway were actually expressing. These particular linked marker genes have indicated good amount, particularly the SPS MEDI, both with the Medicago, this is, with both membrane stability index and relative water content. And what we envisaged was, if we are able to validate these markers, which were tightly linked for both relative water content and membrane stability index, we'll be having greater gains. And that's what Supriya as well as Tappan have published. At the same time, as I said, in that particular population, my colleague and we were looking, what was the basic gene family? And we have seen that ethylene responsive factor, almost 120 ethylene responsive factor under stress, which belong to 120 ERF family members. And they could be clearly distinguished into almost 11 groups, which were actually seen that were being upregulated. Now, what we have seen was, this particular factor, particularly the chickpea arytenum ERF 116, which was most abundant, was seen both under salinity, was also under dehydration, also cold stress, as well as abscisic acid stress. That means this belongs to a family of ubiquitins that is a stress responsive factor, but plays very wide role in case of abiotic stress tolerance. We have actually done a promoter sequence analysis, and Parmeshwaran, who was working on this particularly for heat, was also identified that this is also an heat stress transcription factor. So we have a gold mine in this ERF, and if we are able to exploit the gene-based markers, maybe we'll be in future moving towards multiple stress tolerance. So this was some of the basic studies that have been done in developing of these maps, developing of QTLs, which were tightly linked. One example of how this can be used in abiotic stress tolerance, as well as in developing bold seed size, I've explained. But the one big advantage is they don't have regulatory issues, or there is wider public acceptance. Now, at the same time, Rajiv and Manish put forth the idea that it's okay, we are actually using these QTLs, but Bharadwaj, what we need to do is, we need to use them in the most drought tolerant lines and then actually have better yield gain than them. And that is the real usability of these particular molecular markers, or that is the usability of this translational genomics. So what we had is we had a center of excellence program with DBT, where we were to introduce this QTL from ICC 4958, where this particular QTL has been identified. It has been very much narrowed down by Himabindu Kudupa, Anu Chitikneni, Manish, and his group. And we have seen that NCPGR 127 or NCPGR 21 sits right inside this QTL. Now, the beauty of this QTL, by the studies which Dr. Rajiv Varshney and group has identified, why we call this as a hotspot is, it just not harbors the root volume and the root length, or the root density, related traits, but it also has seed index, that is larger seed size. It has better harvest index. And this really fascinated me and Dr. Madan Pal. And we started looking, can we actually introgress this particular QTL now under the DBT Australia India Strategic Research Fund program. And we started moving this or introgressing this QTL into the elite chickpea lines, whether it is PUSA 372, PUSA 362, RSG 888. Now we are also doing in almost all the mega varieties of Desi. I'm sorry. And in the new Kabuli drought tolerant line, again identified by Chrisat and group. And what we have done, along with Dr. Silesh too, what we started moving is getting this root volume and root density into this less denser line. Now you can ask, Dr. Bharadwaj, you were saying a North Indian condition, this does not work. Just viewers look into the top part of the stem, where the initial biomass of this line, ICC 4958 with few branches is there. We could also bring down the tolerance from PUSA 362 or PUSA 372, which were more branching. And just look at this F1, where it has not only a denser root volume and root length, but it also has better branching or harvesting index. And what we could get a large amount, we could develop a large amount of drought tolerant introgression lines, which were having only the QTL of interest in our particular program. And then what we started doing is we started evaluating these lines before we actually entered into ACRP trials. We have done this testing almost over 10 locations. And when you compare with one of the best lines, whether it is RSG 888, whether it is JG11, whether it is JG16, whether it is DCP92-3 or GG4, all the MABC lines, MABC derived lines, which was under a collaborative breeding program with Dr. Chaturvedi and group at IIPR, most of the NARS partners, you see that we have about 20 lines which were yielding more than 20% than the best check, and 50% lines of these out yielded the best check. Not only that, we started using the wilt tolerant marker, particularly the SNP marker developed by Mahinder Thudi, and all these lines had wilt tolerance in it. The wilt tolerance would have basically come from PUSA 362. Now these lines were actually entered into the All India Coordinated Research Program and tried under drought conditions for 2 years, either it was at Rahuri, whether it was Sihor, Badnapur. And when you look at the moisture stress at flowering, you can look, it is almost very, very negligible, much almost 30% less than field capacity, where breeders say, and at maturity, it was almost very, very less. So under the most drought stress conditions in a multiple location, multi-year trial, this particular line BGM10216, which is a marker-assisted derivative from PUSA 372, gave almost 10 to 16%, on an average 16%, higher yield than PUSA 372. So this was the first drought-tolerant introgression line released in the country, which we have named it as a PUSA chickpea 10216. I frankly admit it is not one person's job. It is a very good collaborative program that has happened between the NARS partners, the ICRISAT, the National Institute of Plant Biotechnology, Dr. Jain, Dr. Varshne, Dr. Manish, and excellently coordinated by the All India Coordinated Research Project in chickpea. Now you see, it is not just the average yield. Even in the drought conditions, it has yielded an yield of 2.5 tons per hectare. Of course, as I said, this particular QTL, which we had in ICC 4958, harbored the seed QTL. So we had a relatively a bit larger seed, 22 grams, but excellent grain color as its recipient parent. And therefore, this was one of the super chickpea that we could release along with the ICRISAT. My young, highly cited friend, Rajiv Varshne there, in all smiles, ever to help an excellent partnership, result of this excellent partnership. At the same time, the robustness of this QTL can be understood that it was not just released in India. It was also released in Ethiopia in the name of Gileto. And this was under a totally different background, JG11. It was released already for commercial production. 1 to 2 months earlier, it was released than BGM10216. And as I said, this line had 2.5 tons per hectare, my line. So this is also validated by the results at almost four locations in Africa. This particular robustness of this QTL, which says it has 3.8 tons per hectare, 15%, we had 16 to 24% over the check. That is, on an average, under different genetic backgrounds, this particular QTL could give 10 to 18% more in not a susceptible variety. That is what the viewers need to understand. This has given in the most leading and drought tolerant varieties, and that is the power when we use the modern tools of plant breeding. We should understand, these are tools. They're not to supplant the breeder. They're not to supplant the entomologist. They're not to supplant the pathologist. They're here as more precise tools, and we need to integrate them fast because the tools are improving, improvising, and it is foolishness to stick on to increase your cost benefits when you have such tools, but to still go through the conventional methods. Conventional methods are very much important when you have to introgress them, when you have to do precise field trials, when you want to use the breeding strategies, but not to use tools per se, like people have resisted when biometrical tools come, becomes costlier to each of the breeder in the long run. Now, as I said, this was, I think, somehow it got repeated, I'm sorry. So similarly, Dr. Banur from Gulbarga and now Dr. Lakshman have developed the super anigiri, which where they have actually pyramided and which has a 7% yield advantage. Whenever you are looking at disease tolerance, we don't look at yield advantage alone. Yield can be same as your introgressed variety, but it should show disease resistance at more locations than the recipient parent, the MABC line. Therefore, we are looking at a stabilizing breeding. But friends, whenever we are breeding for stresses, we always have been hearing from our earlier teachers that it's a stabilizing breeding. But here are two examples, both in case of drought as well as in wilt, where we are not just looking at stabilizing breeding, but we are also looking at increased yield advantages. This is again another stress that we are targeting. Nilesh, his name is missing here. Neeraj, Supriya, Sneha, and Tapan have been working on these lines. Again, it's under an DBT, Australia-India Strategic Research Fund, where we started looking at salt, which is another major stress. We see that a large amount of particularly cultivated or arable land is getting affected by salt, more so in the irrigated belt, as well as Australia, as well as Canada and America. So this becomes a major concern because with greater irrigation and poorer drainage, salt is becoming a problem where staple food crops are not able to grow. Legumes also do not grow, But can we start looking at providing what you call as resilience to these resource poor farmers in these areas? So if you look, as I said, global extent of salt, you will see that a good amount of salt in most of the arable regions of the world has started increasing. And in case of India, when you start looking, whether it is Gujarat or whether it is Andhra Pradesh, Haryana, or whether it is the Madhya Pradesh, the amount of salt stress is increasing, and we need to address particularly this problem, particularly in case of chickpea major producing country. So we started looking at two ways. One is identifying genes using a functional genomics approach, also validating the already identified candidate genes. And now one of my students is working on transcriptomics of the same thing. So what Sneha and Neeraj have basically done in an incentivizing research in agriculture program, along with Supriya, what these people have done using both the national phytotron facilities at IRI, as well as the field facilities at CSSRI Karnal, and along with UW Perth, we have established a rapid hydroponic phenotyping facilities, and you can actually transplant these plants, the resistant plants. So it becomes a beautiful way at F3 or F4, where we can actually screen a large amount of populations, or you can screen a large amount of germplasm, identify them, transfer to the pots, then start using in the crossing programs. So we could identify from the land races per se, this was the work of Tapan, Sneha and Neeraj, where we could identify a good sources, IG5656, this is a land race, IG5895, similarly, ILC0 Latvia. Now, if you remember this race, this land race, which is basically from Latvia, this particular land race was also resistant or tolerant to drought. This is now also showing tolerance to salinity. So that means this has multiple genes which were basically working for both these stresses. Now, these lines we have also evaluated in the microplots. At CSSRI Karnal, we could also identify some traits, particularly the stem sodium is to potassium ratio. Now, when we were looking at different research publications, different workers have indicated the sodium is to potassium ratio. They have indicated that this should be low in root, but invariably in stem. Now, when we started looking, the Neeraj's work, which is actually throwing light, we have seen that root has a way of vacuolizing this higher sodium ion and it does not transport. It does not allow it to be transported to the stem. Invariably, in the resistant genotypes, the stem sodium is to potassium ratio is very low, and he has identified some what you call as transporter proteins and genes related to them that were transcribed at a higher proportion in the transcriptomic studies when he has used the salinity tolerant versus the salinity susceptible lines. Now, in the Sneha's work, what we have seen when we started grouping these particular lines, we could see that most of these tolerant land races grouped along with the well-identified donor ICCV10. We again started looking at the candidate genes which were, and we here identified that apart from CAD, it was also dihydrin. MIP transcription factor was being seen both in case of drought as well as salt stress, and differential genes were getting expressed in different genotypes. If you look into JG62, it was dihydrin. But if you look into ICCV10, it was again dihydrin. But if you look into the newer land race, we have seen that it was CAD. So we need to actually look at which are these genes, and we need to mobilize them. Now, since these were land races, we started moving a little bit further into wild species. And Dr. Sarvjit and his group are initiating evaluating of these lines and wild species derived lines. And while we were looking at the land races derived lines, What peculiarly we have seen in this domestication skew is, when you start looking, if you look, the selective genes for domestication have narrowed, indicating that we were basically looking at basically yield related genes. The selective genes for crop improvement have also greatly decreased. We have lost them. And the non-selective genes or the redundant genes were generally there. Maybe this may be the reason that across legume species, the genome is highly conserved. It has been seen that like across leguminoid, whether it is soybean, whether it is cowpea, whether it is chickpea, whether it is lupin, most of these genes are conserved, and these genes actually indicate the non-selective or the neutral genes. And one of my partner, is actually working on which are these genes. Now I would like to come to one of the most important and the third part of my talk, where I'll be speaking on the new breeding cycle. New breeding cycle is nothing new. It is only that we are using marker tools to improve the breeding efficiency. Now every breeder need to select his lines based on the ability to have higher genetic gain. Now, how is this genetic gain conventionally or as such represented? It's a product of selection intensity into selection accuracy into the additive genetic variance divided by the number of generations that you can take per cycle or in a year. Now, if you look down, what happens is you can as such conventionally increase this genetic gain by taking more number of cycles. That is what Lee Hickey is now advocating, and NAR system as well as Ikrisat is developing a rapid cycling technique. Or already Dr. Gaur and Dr. Sammineni Srinivas from Ikrisat have already indicated that we can do it in case of chickpea in greenhouses, altering the temperature as well as photolight. Increase your intensity by better using biometrical tools. Increase your accuracy over environments. But as you come down to the molecular tools, today the ability to genotype has become very, very cheap. You can genotype large amount of populations, not one or two, you can amount a large amount of populations. You can identify markers which actually give greater yield in a subset. So you can use these markers to make selections in your off-target years or in your rapid generation advancement, and also maintain these favorable alleles, therefore have greater genetic gain. And this is what I or Dr. Varshney or Gaur proposes as the new breeding cycle. Now, if you look at the new breeding program, which is, I thank Gopal Krishna from RISE to have contributed me the slide. So what basically happens when you are using the conventional breeding program versus marker-assisted breeding program versus the genomic selection or double haploid and rapid generation advance with this genomic selection? Basically, the number of years are reduced, right? But if you look at the funnel between the marker-assisted breeding program versus the genomic selection, the number of favorable lines that you are going to handle, you see the funnel base has greatly reduced. That is, your ability increases now to handle a large amount of populations, or in private companies, you have better cost to benefit ratios because you'll be handling lesser number of lines. And you are sure that these lines will be carrying more favorable alleles. And that is the power of genomic selection. Widely already being followed in private companies, wheat in Australia, as well as CIMET advocates, maize in most of the private companies. And we are happy that we are one of the leading crop in case of Indian subcontinent. Now what we have done, again, this was in the second Australia-India Strategic Release Fund grant, again, that was obtained by DBT program. we have set upon on developing along with Puran Gaur, Manish, Varshney group led by Dr. Varshney, a development of a training population. The training population, unlike your what you call as mapping population, is advanced and stable breeding lines where breeder can carry out a selection, may include almost all the elite lines. And what we have done is the 15 years of trials that ICRISAT has conducted in a coordinated program, from that we have selected the best. We had the Kabuli lines as well as the Desi lines. It was a 320 line set training program. We have evaluated in three seasons over two particular locations in two environments. We have done, that time it was the DART sequencing or axiom SNP arrays. And we could identify about 799 DART markers and 693 DART markers. We have used a large amount of modeling techniques to make these markers. Now, for some of the friends who are looking at genomic selection for the first time, particularly for my breeder friends or physiologist group, now a elite line or an elite variety, here as a crop improvement person, line which is yielding high or having certain donor has certain unique characters. But at the same time, since most of these lines are unique, but they also have a common set of gene pool. What we wanted to do in this particular thing is capture this common set of gene pool. At the same time, capture those unique genes or markers, for example, some lines having resistance to fusarium wilt, some were having for Ascochyta blight. So use this marker repertory to carry the next generation of lines, right? So you need to individually develop your training populations. You need to individually validate the models. So we have used a large amount of models, whether it is ridge regression, kinship, or lasso or forest. And we have seen that there were very good prediction accuracies. Now, the prediction accuracy, unlike other crops, we had for certain individual traits ranging as high as 0.89 to 0.91, but also very good for complex or what you call as dependent traits like drought susceptibility index, seed yield under stress, and also very high heritable traits, 100 seed weight and days to flowering. Now, what we started looking is, can we actually make a set of selections? Then we said that since we are having the Kabuli and the Desi lines, we need to actually look whether the selection prediction efficiencies are same in Kabuli versus Desi. And we started looking how Kabuli predicts Desi, how Desi predicts Kabuli. And when we started looking at the simulation models, we have seen that Kabuli is able to predict Desi better in case of what you call as seed weight, whereas Desi is able to predict Kabuli better in case of harvest index or biomass. So we started looking and we started separating these particular groups, and we could clearly see that the groups have clustered among themselves between whether they're originated from ICRISAT Kabuli or whether they were ICRISAT Desi or they were IRI Desi or IRI Kabuli with some overlappings. Now, basically what happened is, now we started making individual prediction accuracies and started looking at the phenotypic values that we obtained. And we clearly saw that it is always good that you make Kabuli-based predictions for Kabuli selections and Desi-based predictions for Desi training sets. But since I was a basic breeder, I said, and what happened is, Nicholas, as well as Manish Rurkiwal, under this program led by Rajiv Varshney, could actually make some predictions for different characters. Now you should understand, genomic selection is basically to identify the parents in level one, that is cycle one, cycle two, so that you are able to cross among these higher genomic value parents and then build the next cycle, which is having better genetic gain per se than the base population. Ideally, whether you are following genomic selection or you are not following genomic selection, breeders or as students of plant breeding, we are taught that we should actually evaluate the breeding value of our parents and the next generation to identify those lines which are having better breeding value to actually propagate that. I hope most of the breeders do that and are aided by bioinformatics people. So the genomic selection, what it does, it increases the accuracy and efficiency of predicting this breeding value, the genomic assisted breeding value. The genomic assisted breeding value can be predicted even in rapid generation advance, where you are not looking at yield and you are relying on the yield based on the molecular data of the model that you have fit in. But now comes the question, and that's what I've asked Rajiv. Rajiv, does it actually predict? If I look how your genomic selection based lines would perform based to my conventional phenotypic biometric based selection, I said I would like to compare before I jump into this program. And that's what I've done. Based on the genomic prediction values that has been given by Rajiv and his group, and based on the phenotypic prediction, what we have done, we have given about 3,000 lines for SNP genotyping, and Manish has given me a set of 200 lines, the best based on the regression model of, for example, drought susceptibility index, seed yield, then other yield parameters. And I have done my own phenotypic selection, 3,000 lines post-harvest observations, yield per se of the plants, and then we have evaluated 200 best based on the genomic selection as well as 200 best what is there on the phenotypic selection. And when we started looking, number one, what we could identify is the genomic prediction better predicted or predicted equal to as the phenotypic prediction, right? You may ask me then why I need to go it. See, this is 1 year of phenotypic prediction. If I had to do these predictions every year in the same environment, I will take 8 years. In rapid generation advancement, generally we do it at off-season facility where we rapidly generate, or you use the greenhouse facilities as given by Dr. Gaur and Saminani, where we can use 6 generations. But we are just what you are doing using a single seed descent, you are carrying all this. So maybe for a cross, I need to carry about 300 to 400 lines. Or if I'm doing just a sampling and doing 1 or 2 lines of sowing or 3 lines sowing bulking, I may be losing most important lines which would have otherwise yielded better. So that is one. Now, if you look above on this particular table, you look that the percentage of prediction accuracy was almost 80% or more in most of the traits. And most importantly, the visual selection based seed output, whereas the marker based seed output almost gave 400% better lines. Now, initially we had certain limitations because the total number of individuals in our training set was 315. I do understand it was very, very low. It need to be very, very high. So the total number of markers, we didn't use a single platform. We had SNPs, we had DARTs. Now Manish is working on this. Dr. Rajiv is leading, where we thought along with the ACRP system, we'll use almost all the released cultivars. We'll use all the lines in our advanced trials. We'll also use all the varieties and the donors and then regress this into the best fit model to carry out and identify parents that we can indicate for different breeding centers, which can be used for the first cycle and the second cycle selection. In brief, friends, when we start looking into it, the next generation genomic approaches are very much useful to develop climate change ready crops. whether it is here or whether it is in any other crop. But at the same time, it is very important that there is a need to develop the basic resources, which the biotechnologist and the bioinformatics. Luckily, we have a very good bioinformatics person, Abhishek Srivastav, who is actually looking at gene ontology studies. Whether it is the genomic resources, whether it is the genetic maps, whether it is the genome sequence assemblies. Thanks to the Center of Excellency in Genomics, which has actually made this orphan crop into a genomic resource-rich crop. Thanks, Rajiv. Then similarly, we require a good germplasm collection or a breeding population that need to be phenotyped of traits of interest. My predecessors, Shyam Singh Yadav, Jay Kumar Deshmukh, Dr. Hari Upadhyay from ICRISAT, they have done an extensive phenotyping of these germplasms, which is now being used for developing of core, whether it is going to be used and further for developing of what you call as reference sets. Good amount of work is required to identify the QTLs. Most important is to validate these QTLs or the candidate genes through functional validation and annotation. Once it is done, you need to actually choose where we have to go for marker-assisted recurrent selection, or which, how much percentage of this variation should be expressed to use that QTL for marker-assisted backcross breeding, or how do we approach for genomic selection or forward breeding. And then, of course, the new technologies are coming. Friends, I would like to say that this PPT was not my alone. I was greatly assisted by my students as well as my friends, Sneha, Neeraj, Supriya, Jorben, who is my doctoral student currently with me, Sneha with me, Nilesh, Harish, Tapan, who was with me, now is a project scientist in ICARDA, Uma Shankar, Apurva, Sangeeta, we have Patel, Madan Pal, my physiologist, friend. Then we had Dr. Hegde, Dr. Silesh Tripathi, as well as Dr. Chauhan, who takes very judiciously all these field experiments. Then from ICRISAT, Patancheru, excellent partnerships, very sound, from Manish Rurkiwal, Rajiv Varshne, now Anu Chitikneni and Mahinder Thudi also joining. Similarly, from National Institute of Plant Biotechnology, we have Jane Nimme is joining slowly for salt tolerance. PAU Ludhiana, excellent field phenomics and evaluation facilities, wide hybridization by Dr. Sarvjit Singh and Shaila Bindra. Then IIPR Kanpur, my good friend, Dr. Soren, Dr. Aditya Pratap, Dr. Chaturvedi, who was leading these programs and also giving guidance, now moved to the Central Agricultural University, Jhansi. My mentor, Dr. N.P. Singh, and good senior colleague and good guidance by Dr. Deekshit. Then a whole lot of team from NIPGR, as I was leading quite a number of collaborative projects with Sabhyata Bhatia, with which we have initially developed the maps where which we published in Nature Scientific Reports, or with Swaroop Parida. Initially, we are working with Dr. Praveen Verma. And at the same time, we were looking at a different approach of submergence tolerance. You may ask, what does submergence tolerance has to do? Now, India is looking at Northeast Plain zones. And here, the what you call as the submergence due to winter rains is very, very high. And we are looking what particular genes or pathways lead to this. And interestingly, what Jagdish, with whom I'm collaborating on this program, is also finding that some of these genes have a role in playing abiotic stress pathways. And also my friend Satish Sanwal from Karnal and other groups. That's what I have. And friends, there is a whole lot of work that is going on genomic assisted breeding in other labs too. I don't say this is only working going on in my lab. a lot of work in CEG, a lot of work in NIPGR, a lot more to be added. But what I have used here in my particular lecture is solely the work or the collaborative work that has taken place from the CHIKPI program of IRI along with its collaborative national partners. Again, I thank Shuo, a good friend, Soma, and the webinar hosting team of BioEngine, Liberty, Jakinta, and Neha. Excellent initiative. And I wish these webinars grow, because these are non-profit and they're doing only for science. Thank you, Shuo. Thank you, everyone. I'm open for questions.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Bharadwaj, sir. It was a very interesting and informative talk. As you say, it is easy to understand for everyone, everybody. And we will now move to our interview session. Meanwhile, we view in our questions answer box from in Zoom and YouTube also, and select if there is any question for you. I'm over to you, Soma, for a interview with the Bharadwaj sir.
Hello, sir. It was a beautiful presentation. Sir, I'm starting the interview now. Sir, our viewers would like to know more about you. Kindly, could you say a few words describing your journey so far as a plant scientist?
I would like to also put down my journey, because I, and as I say, my friend Jagdish Kapuganti from NIPGR, we didn't come from any metro. We didn't come from any big towns. We both hail from a very small village in Andhra Pradesh. I hail from Bubbali, which is almost insignificant, a small village. Similarly, Jagdish hailed from my side neighborhood, Salur. And we almost traversed 10 to 12 kilometers for our studies, almost till fifth or sixth class. Literally a Telugu person. I wanted to put that as a village education. Even Rajiv from a very small school does not stop you from achieving his ambitions if you are focused. I started from there. I did have a chance to join into medical streams or veterinary, but I preferred taking agriculture, because my uncle, father's elder brother, Tauji, was a director of horticulture, and this inspired me. And that time itself, I was focused that I would like to take research as my career. Briefly, for 2 years, I had a stint as a crop executive and rose to the position of deputy crop manager in VST Agro Tech in Hyderabad, which was a multinational tobacco company, but I was looking at breeding paprikas and gherkins. Then since my better half, Dr. Tara Satyavati, who is also a project coordinator for Pearl Millet program, is more a research-oriented girl, and I didn't want to curb her scientific vision. So I also joined back into PhD at IRI. Since I got ARS before I could complete after 2 years of my PhD, I again took up my job as a plant breeder and germplasm curator at Indian Institute of Soybean Research, Indore. And luckily, I could do in service thanks to Indian Council of Agricultural Research. Under the guidance of Dr. S.K. Rao, the present Vice Chancellor of Gwalior University, and under a sandwich program with Dr. Rajesh Mishra, Dr. Janoria, with IRRI, I worked on new plant type of rice for the first time, we have identified the genes that govern the flag lip width, the culm thickness. And I have a good amount of publications in that. So after that, I joined back into my soybean, and later I came to IRI. I became a principal scientist here itself. And of course, the next amount of research is presented to you.
That was nice, sir. Sir, my next question is that how can we translate our knowledge of plant science into food security?
This is a very good question. I always am a follower of Swami Vivekananda. So I always say that it is unbecoming of one person to act as another person. You need to act in a team. So similarly, it is unbecoming of a breeder to become a biotechnologist, of a biotechnologist to become a physiologist, and a physiologist to become an entomologist. You need to have a very clear focus. That's what I said in the starting. You need to have a very clear focus of what your target trait is. Once you have a focus, you need to develop a good team.
Right.
Once you have a good team, you need to develop what you call as clear-cut protocols and alternative protocols. I have just presented genomic assisted breeding as a tool. There are other tools too. I'm not saying this is the only and this is the best tool. There are other tools too. For example, if you look at soybean, we want to improve the protein content. So you needn't jump to the genomic tools. A narrow soybean leaf, the narrower it is, the smaller the seed size. The smaller the seed size, the higher the protein. So that itself is a seedling tool. So what you need to do is whatever objective you have in mind, you should have the clear cut available research that has been done, make a gap research and use them.
Right.
That's what I say. No means every tool appears very fancy and no wind will favor you.
Okay, sir, my next question is that according to you, which sectors of plant science research and agriculture will prosper in the near future?
This is an excellent question. It depends on what you're interested in. Basically, because agricultural sector does not include the research alone. If you're asking for research, it is different. See, when you're looking at as such, then if you need to look, because you asked a broad question, for example, for private companies, still it is the application part. Seed, right? Seed
yes,
production, pathological and entomological products, these gain a lot in private companies, which are looking at applied product databases.
Yes, definitely.
Right?
Yes.
Informatics is a very big tool. Convergence is coming in a big way. So bioinformatics, because a huge amount of data is being generated, huge, very huge. Just a transcriptome, we were having such a large, just from simple transcriptome, that I was taking help from this biogene, Dr. Abhishek Srivastava from Mumbai. So it is a huge amount of tool that is coming up and that will be integrating in a large way. The third is, of course, plant breeding is there to say, but the epigenetics as well as CRISPR-Cas in case of basic research are going to play a major role in the future life.
Okay. Sir, my final question is that, sir, you have so many collaborations worldwide. Sir, could you give some advice or tips for early career scientists on how to initiate and maintain successful collaborations, particularly international collaborations?
I think your bioengine team is one of the best example of how close friends make a very practical and most useful collaborations. I was talking with Shuvo, and I know that you are all acquaintances at some stage and you have started. So yes, the best collaborations are initiated in your colleges and universities, right?
Yes, sir.
When you're initiating and when you attend these seminars or symposias, you tend to identify. Now, Government of India, as well as international CGR partners, have excellent, what you call as funding facilities, whether it is Netaji Subhash Fellowship or the earlier career facilities, fellowships that is being given both by DBT, TST, and ICAR. So these are one where you can get very good early funding facilities. And particularly more so for if you are from the what you call as the feminine gender, because government, yeah, it's important that you bring equity, so you mm-hmm. are able to really That's get right. them, because always women are good analytical thinkers, where men are good at mechanical thinking. So we need to get better gender this thing, and already you have seen even the director of ICRISAT latest is madam. So it is yes. very, very important that we understand that you need to tap into facilities. You need to look into mm-hmm. DRDO gives, inter-university consortium gives. So once you are dubbed, it is very easy. See, no one would come to you if you just put theories. You need to work upon.
Exactly.
Initially, I mm-hmm. said, you need to focus. You can't put your finger in 10 things and get everything. You become Jack. So it is important that you focus on your line of work. You identify which are these best labs, where it is,
mm-hmm.
and then you start getting trained. They help you. These days, you have
yes.
Many facilities for training also, mm-hmm. and then you make your collaborations then.
Thank you, sir. It was our privilege to have you with us today. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. We have received many positive feedbacks on your talk from our many viewers, and we hope to see you again on the BioEngine platform in the future. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. You have any questions? I was just asking. Or
I'm giving it over to Shubho.
Hello, sir. Yes, we are searching for some questions, and few are very, very basic, and I know the answer what will be that. Everybody asking for when they getting the drought tolerance chickpea varieties in the field. Or
I have already indicated we got. It has been released. BGM 10216 last year is the first drought tolerant chickpea variety that has been released. This year, we have already 4 in pipeline, AVT2, 2 years of trials completed. This variety was not released. It was also identified and released by Central Variety Release Committee. It's already gone into the seed chain. This year, from it will be moving from the nucleus to the breeder's seed chain. And rather, our Honorable Director, Dr. A.K. Singh, want to mobilize this variety in a big way, because this variety has been released. You should understand the importance for CVRC, Central Variety Release Committee. It has been released for Central Zone, which is the largest chickpea production area in the country. And the biggest constraint there is drought. So you can understand the importance. That is why the Government of India has already released. So we can tell them, yes, we have released it and it is already moving.
Okay. So another question I got that, which variety will be preferable for mechanical harvesting? I think.
There are a lot of mechanical harvesting varieties that have been released for different zones. This program again was started with the DAC fund initiation led by Dr. Puran Gaur, of which almost 8 partners, including IRA, was there. More than 8 varieties have been released, and recently IRA has released Dr. Sailesh Tripathi, Pusa Parvati, but you have even other varieties for different zones that have been already released and already under the public domain, like the DTIL.
Okay, sir. And I think we have these type of questions, and others are not so related to your presentations, and these answers can be found from the Google, or they can contact to you if they want. So I want to thank you again. Thank you, sir, for your valuable time. Hope to see you again soon on the BioEngine platform with your more advanced and more ongoing works and delivered to the public, deliverable. Your talk and interview will be available on our YouTube channel, and I will send the link to you also. I'm sure your talk has inspired many of our future plant scientists and motivated them. Thank you. You can disconnect from the meeting. Thank you, everybody, and thank you, sir, for giving your talk. Okay, bye. Okay, bye, sir. Now I ask to Soma to give your view some important guidelines regarding the process of registration and certificate collection. And this link is working, and we already got about 650 certificate application. So be patient. You guys not need to hurry to apply. It sometimes it's the server is blocked due to how many to high applicant. So the link is okay. Password is okay. 2 hours, this link will be activated. No request after that 2 hours will be entertained for the certificate distribution. Over to you, Soma.
Yes. Okay. We are truly grateful to Dr. C. Bhardwaj for sharing his experience and knowledge with our global plant enthusiasts. We are thankful to the audience for attending the webinar. Hope you enjoyed it. Thank you, Shuvo and Neha and Jacinta of Team BioEngine for being with us today. We owe special thanks to our active volunteers who have helped us put together this event. The certificate collection link is now open for all the registered attendees and available on our website. We have already displayed the password and you will require that you will require while filling out the certificate application form. You can get the link and password from the comment box here. Please fill out the application form carefully so that there are no spelling mistakes. Please type in your name the way you want it on your certificate, and please don't make any requests later that change my name or put doctor in front of my name. Please write it, whatever you want on your certificate, you type that on the application form. Okay, and definitely please type in the correct password. An incorrectly filled certificate application form will be automatically discarded. Also note that the certificate application link will only be active for 2 hours from now. No requests, formal or informal, will be entertained after this time. The certificate of attendance for the webinar will reach you within 7 working days by email. Please wait for 7 working days. And if you're still awaiting your certificate after 7 days, then write to us. We have our certificate distribution team who are part of our active volunteers. They are Rene from Philippines, Shubham from India, Prudhvi Kumar from India, Prathamesh from India, Krishna Chaitanya from India, Aman from India, Sanjay from India, and Mukesh from India. This is our certificate distribution team. You will receive your certificate from an email which will consist of these names. Okay, one of these names. The topic of our next webinar is development of climate change resilient rice varieties through molecular breeding. The speaker is Dr. Raman Meenakshi Sundaram, Principal Scientist, Biotechnology, ICR, Indian Institute of Rice Research, ICARIIRR, Hyderabad, India. It is on 6 July 2020 at 11 a.m. Please visit our website or Facebook page to register. All the webinars are free and open to all. To learn about the process of registration and certificate application, please watch the descriptive videos on our YouTube channel. The webinar video recording will be uploaded on our YouTube channel. Please like, share, and follow our Facebook page. Please like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube channel to stay connected to BioEngine. Our YouTube channel also consists of videos about the upcoming webinars by BioEngine for the month of July 2020. Thank you all for making this webinar successful. See you soon at our next webinar. All the essential links have been provided in the comment box. Over to you, Shuvo.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Soma. Thank all our audience. We will meet again on 6th July in our next webinar. And I want to request all the audience, please collect the joining link from our website just beneath the webinar, because we facing problem to sending individual mails, because many mails are just bounced back due to the security reason, or maybe due for the bulk sending it. So make a habit, if you want to attend BioEngine webinars, the link always be present in our website. There is a notice box in there. Go there and collect their collect the link, and you can also use the subscribe option. So you just get a update when we are going to live for the webinar. So I highly recommend, please subscribe YouTube channel, because hosting Zoom is for 500 people and is very difficult to enter sometime. So please choose the alternative option for going to the and attend the webinar from the YouTube channel. The link, many of people are found this link is not working, but I assure that link is working, and I'm getting continuous application for the certificate. So please go for the link. It is okay, and if it's not working, wait 1 or 2 minutes, then try, because many people are hit on the link at the same time. All registered attendees on YouTube will get a certificate. All the upon application, all the viewers on the YouTube also get a certificate upon the application. And if don't ask any request by in Facebook chat or email or WhatsApp for the link and password is working, and I'm giving, and I'm also wait for that link. I'm waiting for here few more minutes to assure that you have got the link. So please try. This link is working, and I got so many. I already got 885. We already got 888 applicant for the certificate. So how I can say that link is not working? It's just work. You have to give some time and apply to that. Another thing I want to say that please follow us in Facebook, so where you can got the instant message of our all upcoming webinars, or you can subscribe YouTube, or you follow our website up to date. And I'm also already shared our yearly planner and yearly calendar, so you guys know that when we are going to plan and going to launch our webinars. So okay, I'm here. I'm just stop and wait for a few minutes to give the link. And so is there any problem facing by anybody? I request Neha, you can go, or you can wait for a few minutes. And thanks to everybody for watching us. Thank you. We hope we all see you in our next webinar, which is on 6th of this month. And registration of this webinar will, registration link will available in our website.
03627 7. स्कोर बोल रहे ना, स्कोर एलो बोल रहे हैं। हर जगह ना वैसे है, बोले इग्नोर कर स्कोर एलो बोल रहे हैं।
এত ঘন ঘন ওয়েবিনার সাথে গেলে তখন মরে যাবে না, বছরে একটা ওয়েবিনার থাকে দুটো ওয়েবিনার থাকে মানুষ থাকতে পারবে। Mm-hmm.